The city's attitude towards its British roots would change during the next decade. For the first time in its history, London would escape the shadow of its English namesake and create its own voice in North America. And it all started with a student who had flunked out of the Ontario College of Art.
What about this piece with all the nose on it? Were you trying to kid anybody with that?
No, maybe I was. It's hard to say. There it is. What are you going to say about it? Some people will think I was kidding them, some people won't. As it was, I just wrote no on a painting I was doing, and the no speaks, and it comes out and it says it. You can't be more explicit than that.
Most of London's establishment didn't understand Greg Curnoe's work. Those who did hated it, including the director of the public art gallery, who was openly horrified with one exhibition. But the younger crowd felt the 25-year-old brought a fresh approach to the art community, and unlike earlier London artists, Curnoe's talent was entirely homegrown. Inspired by the teachers at H.B. Beale's art program, Curnoe decided to work out of his own community.
Jack Chambers dropped by, I believe within about the first year of Greg making that decision, and he was just back from Spain, where he had married and done some training, was thinking about going back to Spain, until he dropped by Greg's place and saw this one artist saying, "Damn it, I'm going to stay here. There's no way, there isn't enough in the ground from which we take our nourishment, the place where we happen to have all these relatives, that, you know, this place is meaningful for me, and I know that if I look deeply enough and hard enough, this will be enough to sustain a career." So the whole explosion of the arts that began in the early 60s, the absolute linchpin in that whole thing was Greg Curnoe, but it was Curnoe and ultimately about two dozen other people all coming to the same decision. We will go down the 401 to Toronto no more.
People said in Toronto, "Gee, you've got Greg Curnoe to design one of your shows. He's designed a puppet show for you. Chambers has designed a theater and so on and for you and all that. We can't get anybody to help us at all down in Toronto." And Keith Turnbull said, "Well, it's because it's so blah here, you have to do something."
Curnoe cultivated everything. Films, plays, art magazines, galleries, and music. He was also determined to promote the work of his fellow artists. He once turned down an offer from the Art Gallery of Ontario to stage his own exhibition, preferring to share the spotlight with his colleagues.
Greg wanted to see a scene here. He wanted to see things happen. And he did not want to be the leader of everything.
If there was a couple of young artists who might start painting like Greg, he got quite annoyed about that sort of thing, because they weren't doing their own thing. They were reading art magazines and not working out of their own experience.
I just want to keep it the way it is, where my painting is integrated with everything else I do, where I feel genuine about it. As long as I feel the work is genuine, I think that there are going to be similarities between paintings.
I think the thing about him was that he somehow was completely normal and sweet and communal and friendly and yet still an artist, instead of being bitchy and selfish and mean the way some of them are, you know, with a swarm of discarded girlfriends and a couple of suicides, the Andy Warhol thing. That sort of thing just never appealed to Greg. His things were always community, having fun together, and unconsciously being a role model for kids.